Hey everyone,
and welcome to Integrity Church Online.
We are so glad you're here. Let's get started.
Hi everyone, and welcome to Integrity Church. Thank you so much for joining us. I'm Connie.
And I'm Paul.
And here you are so loved by all of us at Integrity Church and also loved by God. So we hope that you know that and feel that and feel welcomed. Basically, we want everyone to be inspired to passionately follow Jesus because that's really what it's all about. It's all about His works, His plan, and His glory. So we hope that you're inspired to do that here today.
Absolutely. And we are so excited that we are starting a new series. It's a series called Catch the Foxes, and it's from the Song of Solomon. Specifically a verse, chapter 2, verse 15, where it says, catch the foxes for us, the little foxes that spoil the vineyards, for our vineyards are in blossom. And the foxes in this case are the distractions and the things that keep us from our relationship with Christ. So we are excited to start the series with you and looking forward to doing this.
So why don't we all join together for a time of worship?
Good and you are you are good. You know what you are doing, God. And like it says in your word, you work all things together for those who are called according to your purpose, and that's us. We thank you, God, for that truth. And Lord, in this interesting time that we're all going through together, I thank you just for your truth. Thank you for your promise. Thank you for your constant working, your faithfulness that we can look to and run to, Lord. I pray, Lord, that that we would see you and that your spirit would revive us, Lord. And whatever measure that looks like in each of our individual lives, Lord, you know what each one of us needs. And Lord, I just pray that your spirit would just encourage us through these times. That your spirit would draw us closer to yourself, that it would bring revival for your glory and your glory alone, Lord. We thank you.
Come awaken your people. Come awaken
you can't break through, no mountain you can't move, all things are possible. There's no broken body you can't raise, no soul that you can't save, all things are possible. All things are possible.
Yes.
Yes, God, we believe that.
Jesus, you will.
Lord, the victory is yours. You and you alone are God in heaven. And you are the God who is in control of all things. You are sovereign over every circumstance. As we behold you in your beauty, in your power, in your strength, in your holiness, God, I pray that we would just be humbled before you and encouraged at the same time, knowing that the same God who spoke all of this world into existence and all the galaxies and everything that exists cares intimately about each one of us here. As we behold Jesus on that cross, I pray that the love that he poured out upon us that day would just continually echo and reverberate in our minds, and that we would respond to him by saying yes to your will, Lord, every single day. We are just in awe of you today, Lord. I prayed as we hear your word today that it would just infiltrate us, that it would just break up some ground that needs to be broken up so that we can respond to you in love, in such a love that comes directly from the Father, filters out through us into others. That's the kind of love that we want to emit, your love, Lord. We are so grateful to be in this place together. And it's in Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen. Amen.
Good evening. Isn't that wonderful? Want to see something wonderful? Take a look around you. It's good to be together. All right? Well, you may be seated. It's good to be worshiping with you tonight. It's always good when the people of God come together and give God the glory that's due his name. Amen. So to take a moment, I want to pray for our country, pray for all that's kind of going on around us. It's always good as the people of God that we come together, and let's just take a moment of prayer together. Father, we lift up our nation to you right now. Lord, you know all that's going on in it as well as over it. We recognize we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and rulers of this dark age. And so we pray, Father, that you would have your way in this nation. We pray, Lord, that as we sang, that, Lord, you would send the winds of revival upon us. Lord, that you would revive this nation once again. We pray for our leaders, that you'd give them wisdom, that they would recognize their need for you and they would lean upon you. We pray for the church in this hour, that we'd not get sidetracked by all of the talking points of the day, but that we would stay on mission, bringing the good news of Jesus Christ to all of those that we come to contact with. We thank you, we praise you, in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, tonight we are going to begin a new series, at least for the month of August. This is great weather. I don't know about you, but I could take this off. This is perfect. This is wonderful. And the series that we're going to start is really going to be kind of like going to be springboarding off of one verse that's tucked away in the Song of Solomon. How many like the Song of Solomon? How many read the Song of Solomon? Don't tell people about it. I know you read the Song of Solomon. It's a good book to read. It's an inspired word of God. But you know, to really appreciate the verse that we're going to look at and springboard off of, you have to understand what's going on in the Song of Solomon, also known as the Song of Songs, is another title for that book. The Song of Solomon, like the book of Revelation, doesn't lack interpretive challenges. It doesn't lack debate amongst theologians and scholars as to really what's going on in the book. There is a lot of speculation about the book, this particular book, as to really what it is that we're looking at. Some say, well, it's just an allegory, a spiritualizing of a story oftentimes at the expense of the plain text. Some would suggest that what we have in the Song of Solomon is an extended type, something that we read that points us to the Lord Jesus Christ. Others suggest that what we have is simply a drama that is unfolding before us that is about two, perhaps maybe three people in this drama. Some have concluded that this is nothing more than a collection of Syrian wedding songs or a collection of pagan fertility cult liturgies. I mean, the opinions about the book, this particular book, the Song of Solomon, are very diverse. Some say it's an anthology of disconnected songs extolling human love. And so the Song of Solomon is not without opinion and speculation, because if you've spent some time reading through the Song of Solomon, you might walk away saying, I can't believe that's in the Bible. Now, if you haven't read the Song of Solomon, that might encourage you to jump on in there. You know, when it comes to Bible interpretation, or what we would call hermeneutics, which is really what Bible interpretation is, something I put a very high, that I put very high on my list of importance when it comes to Bible interpretation is a consistent interpretive or a consistent hermeneutic approach. In other words, I look at a text and I filter the text through the context of who is the author, who is the audience that this is being written to, what is the setting or the time period, what is the plain meaning of the text, or how does what I'm reading tie into the bigger theme of Scripture. All of these things must be considered when we're trying to understand and interpret the Scripture. I approach the Bible all the same way, which I believe is the way we are to read and interpret the Scripture. Here's the problem with having an inconsistent hermeneutic or an inconsistent way of reading the Bible. If the Song of Songs or the Book of Revelation was solely allegorical, in other words, if those books didn't really mean what they said, but they had a higher spiritual significance, as some would suggest, well, then how do I know that the Book of James doesn't have that same higher spiritual sense, or Romans? So if I don't know, if I apply inconsistent ways of interpreting the Scripture, my whole theology will break down, because how do I know I'm supposed to interpret this way here, that way here, and that way here? It's doomed to failure and confusion. I do believe a text can have two intended meanings, an immediate meaning and a future spiritual meaning, so long as they're not set in opposition to one another. Now, I know that's probably more heady than maybe some of you may want to go, but I think it's important for us to understand, how do we look at Scripture like this, namely the Song of Solomon? We address some of this when we're going through the book of Revelation. But how do we read this? And I think what we need to see it as reading it consistent with what's laid out there for us. What is the Song of Solomon about? Well, it clearly presents and celebrates a passionate love that is shared between two people. It's a beautiful gift that God has given for these two people to enjoy. And as we read through the book of this particular book, we're invited to sit in on this journey between these two people as they go through a courtship period, and then they move into marriage, and then they move into seasons of marriage, and as that love continues to mature. Now, a little heads up before you turn this book into a family devotional with your young ones, you may want to preview it first. You might find yourself in an embarrassing, having to answer some hard questions, because the author spares no expense in communicating the passionate, physical, and exciting love that is to be enjoyed in the context of that sacred covenant of marriage. And so in addition to seeing this as a shared love between two human beings, it is certainly appropriate to recognize that the shared love that exists between a husband and a wife, as we see all throughout the scripture teaching it, is a type or an example of the kind of love that Christ has for his church, for his bride. And we're going to take a look at that for a moment, because I really want to, it's important that we kind of set the stage a little bit for this. I know a lot of people have a really hard time connecting the passionate love that exists between a husband and a wife and the love that exists between Christ and his church, primarily because of the sexual aspect of things. However, we must remember something very important. Sex is not a dirty thing. God created it. And it's to be celebrated and enjoyed in the confines of a covenant marriage between a man and a woman. And when that takes place, sex is a holy thing that God has created. And it's important to not allow the world and the view of the world, the world's view of sex, to taint or misinform what God has created and called holy. Amen? Now, I hate to disappoint you if you're sitting here thinking, he's doing a sex series tonight. Or if you're here with your kids, you're thinking, he's doing a sex series tonight. I'm not doing a sex series tonight, at least not right now. I'm not even going to be teaching through this book exhaustively. But if I were to summarize the entire book of the Song of Solomon, what it would look is, it would look something like this. And actually, I'm looking forward to kind of teaching this through in an upcoming marriage conference, because the insight that we see in this book in the Bible is extremely significant. But if I were to kind of outline this book for you, really what we see here is we see the courtship period, right? And what we hear and we read about is these expressions of these two who are longing to be together. And then as we move a little further, we see the marriage taking place. We see the wedding procession. We see their first night together in detail. We hear about all of the emotions that are flying. And then as they are ongoing and growing in their marriage with one another, we see that there is at times there's indifference. We see how they resolve indifference. And we see the ongoing pursuit of love in marriage in this book. We see also this greater desire for deeper intimacy between these two. And so that's going to be a fun series that'll yet to come, and I'll give you a heads up before we just jump right in there. But it's a big picture, or a picture of two lovesick souls that long to be together, who are enraptured in each other's love. And I think that's worth celebrating. Amen? Wow, that was really lame. Man, if your love isn't passionate, there's something going on. You got to get some help. You got to read a book. You got to do something. Talk it through, right? But God created it. And it's not meant to be humdrum and boring. And if you read through the Song of Solomon, you'll see anything but that. I mean, and as you read through, you got to remember, this was written about 970 BC. That's like 3,000 years ago that this was written. And so some of the comparisons that the author makes about his bride, if you made those same comparisons to your bride, you would be in a lot of trouble. And so some of it kind of gets lost a little bit over the this period of time. Let me just read a section of it for you. Song of Solomon, chapter 2, verse 1. Look, it says, She says, I am the rose of Sharon, a lily of the valleys. And he says, as a lily among brambles or as a lily among roses, so is my love among the young women. Oh, yes, you are. She says, as an apple tree among the trees of the forest, so is my beloved among the young men. Anybody's wife ever compare them to an apple tree? That's what I'm saying. Some of this kind of gets lost a little bit over time, right? But she says, oh, as an apple tree among the trees of the forest, so is my beloved among the young men. With great delight I sat in his shadow, and his fruit was sweet to my taste. He brought me to the banqueting table, and his banner over me was love. Sustain me with raisins, refresh me with apples. Really? That's like, give me, okay. Sustain me with raisins, refresh me with apples, for I am sick with love. Do you hear the passion? Do you hear the pure desire between these two people? His left hand is under my head, and his right hand embraces me. I adjure you, O daughters of Jerusalem, by the gazelles or the does of the field, that you not stir up or awaken love until it pleases or until it's time. I love the wisdom of Solomon here. He's recognizing, listen, for you young folks, and I'll let you decide if you're in that audience or not, but listen to what he says here. He's recognizing the power of love, the influence of love, the passion of love, and he's saying, don't awaken love before it's time. Don't stir up things that you're not ready to follow through on. Be careful and move slowly. Listen to the bride as she adores her husband. The voice of my beloved, behold, he comes, leaping over the mountains, bounding over the hills. My beloved is like a gazelle or a young stag. Now, my wife has called me a lot of good things in our day. Never before has she likened me to a gazelle or a young stag. Look what she says. Look, behold, my beloved is like a gazelle or a young stag. Behold, there he stands behind our wall, gazing through the windows, looking through the lattice. Notice what I said before, how sometimes things get lost in the interpretation. Because here we are 3,000 years later, we would call that what? A stalker, right? What do you mean he's in my window, looking in my window, right? But this was something that they appreciated. This is something they loved and longed for. You translate that into this day. Listen, guys, this is not what your girl wants. Don't be looking through her window, okay? So, but look, she says, my beloved speaks and says to me, arise, my love, my beautiful one, and come away. For behold, the winter is past. The rain is over and gone. And she's really, what he's doing, they're talking about their courtship period. The wedding day is rapidly approaching. Behold, the winter is past, the rain is over and gone, the flowers appear on the earth, the time of singing has come, the voice of the turtle dove is heard in our land, the fig trees ripen its figs, and the vines are in blossom. They give forth fragrance. Arise, my love, my beautiful one, and come away. Oh, my dove, in the clefts of the rock, in the crannies of the cliff, let me see your face. Let me hear your voice, for your voice is sweet and your face is lovely. This guy is smooth, right? This is great. I mean, this is what, as you read through, this is a lot of what you see going on in this book that God has preserved for us to read. And at this point, they're deep into courtship. And notice how the season of their relationship is being described as the flowers are now appearing and the time of singing has come, that celebration. The fig tree is starting to ripen, vines are starting to bloom and becoming more fragrant. In other words, it's a season of love. The long-awaited wedding ceremony is about to begin, followed by the consummation of that sacred covenant between these two. It's the picture of two lovers that long to experience the greatest depths of relationship together. And you see, when you love someone so much, then you hate the things that compete or undermine that love, right? When you love someone so much, you hate anything that would compete or undermine that love, which is what this following text is all about. And it's this text that we're going to springboard off of these next couple of weeks together. Because what I read to you so far, you will see it all throughout the book, this book of the Song of Solomon. But this one passage, chapter 2 and verse 15, is in response to anything that would come against and compete or undermine that love. Verse 15 says, "Catch the foxes for us, the little foxes that spoil the vineyards, for our vineyards are in blossom." Solomon likens their love to a vineyard that is about to burst into its full potential as it blooms into marriage. But he recognizes that it will never fully blossom if the foxes that spoil the vineyard, even the little foxes, are allowed to roam. He paints a picture of a beautiful garden, which is the picture of their love. And what he says here is, catch the foxes for us, the little foxes, the ones that spoil the vineyards. For our vineyards, our love is about to blossom. Now, as I mentioned before, there are two parallel relationships that this is pointing to. This is certainly the marital relationship. And for those who are married or those who are planning to be married, there is much in here in this text to glean from and apply to our own lives. This is certainly a celebration of the sacred gift of marriage that God has created for us to enjoy. But it also parallels the love between Jesus and the church. And if you're a Christian, you're a part of the church. And so it parallels a love between Jesus and you. Now that might just freak some of you out and thinking, well, I've read through the Song of Solomon, and when I read those passages, what doesn't come to mind is a lot of the details that the Song of Solomon includes in there. And if you could just allow for a moment to step aside from the details and recognize that what this is talking about is not so much the act of love, but just the full embodiment of what love is. Now, I want to take a moment and just kind of build a theology here to help you understand that there is a clear connection between the love that God creates between a husband and a wife and the love that exists between Christ and his church. Paul writes to the church at Ephesus in chapter 5 and verse 30. Says, "Because we are members of his body, therefore a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and these two shall become one flesh." He's reiterating what is said in the Pentateuch in Genesis chapter 3. And then he says this about it. This mystery, what mystery? This mystery of marriage, this mystery of the uniting of these two. He says, this mystery is profound. And I'm saying that it refers to Christ and the church. The two lives that come together and are united to become one is a type, a symbol of Christ's love for the church. Paul, in writing to the church at Corinth in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, says this, "For I feel a divine jealousy for you." He's addressing some chaos that's going on in the church, and he's wanting to call them to repentance, to kind of come back to the Lord. And he says, "For I feel a divine jealousy for you, since I betrothed you to one husband to present you as a pure virgin to Christ." What Paul is saying here is, I was used of God to bring you to Christ. You were the bride of Christ. Jeremiah, we see a lot of references in the book of Jeremiah that we see laid out how God likens himself as a husband to his people. Jeremiah chapter 2 and verse 2, God says to Jeremiah, "Thus says the Lord, I remember the devotion of your youth, your love as a bride, how you followed me in the wilderness in a land not sown." God is laying out there the day in which Israel once was pursuing God out of love. And God's saying, "I remember the devotion of your youth, your love as a bride, how you followed me in the wilderness, in a land not sown." A little bit later in Jeremiah, as his message to Israel is to return, to come back, we see he says in verse 14 of chapter 3, "Return, O backslidden children, says the Lord, for I am married to you. I will take you, one from a city, two from a family, and I will bring you to Zion." God's saying, "Return, O backsliding children. I am married to you." You might be here today or listening to whatever online thing we have going out there, and that might be you. You might be in a place where you're just feeling disconnected from God. You know the truth, but you've walked away from it. I want to tell you, God is married to you. God is saying, "I'm married to the backslider. I'll not let go of you." Jeremiah chapter 3 and verse 20, "But like a woman unfaithful to her husband, so you have been unfaithful to me, O house of Israel, declares the Lord." So again, we see God likening that relationship to that of a husband and a wife. Isaiah chapter 54, "For your maker is your husband. The Lord of hosts is his name, and your Redeemer is the Holy One of Israel. He is called the God of the whole earth." Your maker is your husband. And let's not forget the entire book of Hosea, where God calls the prophet to go and marry a prostitute who will be unfaithful to him and who will bear children by other men, and then will say that in the same way that this prostitute was unfaithful to you, so has Israel been unfaithful to me, says the Lord, though I have been a husband to her. God calling his people back to that passionate relationship with him. And so I point all these verses out to demonstrate that not only is the Song of Solomon in the Bible to help us appreciate and celebrate the love between a husband and a wife, but it is to point to us to one of the most important relationships, that being the relationship that we have with Christ. There is no deeper relationship described in the Bible than in that sacred covenant of marriage where the two become one flesh. God has created that so that we would understand the kind of love and the kind of depth that God has created and his love for us. And so for this series, I want to talk to you about those profound words that were penned by Solomon. as the fields were about to blossom, as love was about to be in full bloom, he says, catch the foxes for us, the little foxes that spoil the vineyards, for our vineyards are in blossom. The title of our series is Catch the Foxes. Catch the Foxes. We're going to talk about identifying and catching those foxes that spoil your love and your passion for God. Because every one of us have something that comes into our life that competes for our love for God. Things that pull us away. Things that cause compromise in our devotion and our adoration of God. These little foxes. Notice Solomon distinguishes between foxes and little foxes. Catch the foxes for us, the little foxes. There's the full-grown foxes that are obvious, that are clearly defined as a detriment to the garden of your soul. Things that would easily and quickly compromise your love for God. The foxes, they are obvious. They are non-debatable things that Christians know they shouldn't be partaking in. We're going to talk about a couple of those in the weeks ahead. Some of those foxes, those things that maybe nobody else knows about except you and God. Those things that nip at the vines of the garden of your soul and undermine and cheapen and lessen that love that you have for Jesus. There's the obvious ones, but Solomon also makes reference to the little foxes. Those are the things that aren't so obvious. That on the surface, they don't appear to be a threat. They don't appear to hinder our walk with God. On the surface, it may appear fun and cute, even innocent. They are the little foxes that don't appear to pose a threat. The problem with the little foxes is that in time, they develop into full-grown foxes. In fact, they are even more dangerous than the full-grown foxes because they've been around for a while. And we've gotten used to them. And we've played with them. The problem with the little foxes is that inside the little fox is a full-grown fox that, if not dealt with, will eat at the vines and undermine that relationship. That's what the author was saying. Don't let the foxes in the garden. Look out for the little foxes. Don't let anything get in and cause compromise to our love. And let me tell you, those who are married here today, likewise, watch out for the little foxes in your marriage. Those little things that you think aren't that big a deal, those little foxes eventually grow into full-grown foxes. But those dangerous little foxes that linger for a while, we become a little familiar with. We become at ease with. Our guard drops down. It's those little white lies that really aren't that big a deal. It's just a little extra drinking here and there. Maybe it's a second glance at somebody you shouldn't be taking a second glance at. Those flirtatious conversations that you think you're in control of. They're little foxes that will grow, and if not dealt with, will wreak havoc and spoil the garden of your relationship with God. Something to consider tonight. What have you allowed into the garden of your relationship with God? What has this pandemic given you permission to allow into your life that you would have never allowed to come in the past? Those little foxes that work their way in, that cause compromise. What have you allowed into the garden of your relationship with your spouse? Where has guards gone down? What have you engaged in that you said you'd never do? Solomon says, catch the foxes, the little foxes, before they wreak havoc in the garden of our love. And so I've set the stage for where we're going to go. But what do we do with this information that we just talked about? I certainly don't want to drop a guilt bomb on you. You'd be like, hey, good luck with that now. Going home. What do we do with this? I just want to take a moment and just in the quietness of our own hearts to examine your own heart. Whether you're here or watching live or watching online or TV or some other means, begin to identify those foxes that have come into your garden. Those big and little foxes. And instead of exiting our time together tonight feeling guilty and feeling like a loser, because that's certainly not the desire here at all. I think if we all got honest, every one of us has something that gets in the way of our love for Jesus. What are those little foxes? And just in the quietness of your heart, ask the Holy Spirit to show you what is that thing that gets in the way. Begin to identify those foxes. John says this. John says, I write these things that you might not sin. But if you do sin, you have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And if this message makes you feel a little bit uncomfortable, good. I felt uncomfortable preparing my own heart for it. But that discomfort is there to cause us to bring those things to the Lord who grants forgiveness. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness, right? As far as the east is from the west, so has he removed our transgressions from us. And so as we continue to move out, it's important for us to begin to look and say, God, what is it in my own life? Lord, what is it? What am I doing now that I said I'd never do? What relationships are being entertained that I never would have entertained in the past? What practices am I engaging in that I said I'd never do this, but here I am, I find myself? Those are the little foxes or the big foxes bring them to Father tonight and ask God's forgiveness. Confess to the Lord and receive the forgiveness of God tonight. There's nothing like a clean slate. Only God can do that. No church, no priest, no organization, nobody can wipe clean the slate of your life. Only the blood of Jesus Christ shed for you freely. And so we ask God's forgiveness, and He is so free and willing to give. Clean the garden, catch the foxes, and let your love for God blossom. Don't let anything get in the way of your passion for Jesus. Let's pray. Jesus, we thank you that you came, that the Father so loved the world that he sent the Son, that whosoever would believe in you would not perish but have everlasting life. Lord, you stepped into our sinful lives and you brought forgiveness, wholeness, reconciliation through the blood of Jesus Christ. Maybe you're here tonight and you've never asked Jesus to be Lord of your life. You've been around it, you've heard it, but you've never crossed the line and recognized, I'm a sinner and I need a Savior. Tonight, the scripture says, today is the day of salvation. Don't leave today without asking Jesus to forgive you of your sins, to come into your life and be the Lord and Savior of your life. You know what the Lord is? The Lord means He's in control. He calls the shots. He drives. We're the passenger. Jesus has done that for us. Or maybe you've done that and you're just not where you know you need to be. And just now, Lord, forgive me. Forgive me, Lord. I pray, Lord, for each and every person here and those who are listening through whatever means. I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would draw each one to Jesus today, that they'd find wholeness and healing and forgiveness in you. Thank you, God, that you do not operate in the arena of guilt and shame. Lord, those are tools of the enemy. You operate in the arena of forgiveness and wholeness and restoration and purpose. And I pray, Lord, that each and every person would experience that today. Thank you that you invite us to experience your love for us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Forgot to turn on the handheld. It is really good to see all of you here today, and for every week that we're having these outside services, to see more people come and to engage and to worship and connect with God and one another. That is really fantastic, and it's so good to be able to worship in person and hear Pastor Tony preach and come together as the body. And for those of you who are used to our little Connect cards, we still have our digital Connect cards on our phones. There we go. So that you could pull up the Integrity Church app and connect with us. Even if you're watching this live on the internet or recorded later, connect with us via the Integrity app. And you could download that from any sort of app store or Play Store or anywhere that you have a digital store for your phones. So if you want to whip that out and check in right now, that'd be fantastic. Also, if you brought a physical offering with you tonight, in that little box over there, just off stage left, you could put it in there or still donate via the internet or through texting means, which I've set up, or through the app. But at this time, if you would please pray with me for our offering. Dear Jesus, thank you so much for every gift that you've given us, God, for the fact that we're all healthy and that we're here tonight, worshiping together in spirit and in truth. That is fantastic, Lord. And I ask that you continue to permit us to gather in person and to keep us healthy and to take every gift that's given to the church, Lord, and to multiply it so that it may be used well to make your name great and famous on Long Island. So, Lord, thank you for being in our midst, and may we persist in generosity, Lord, in time, talent, and treasure, so that when the world gets more challenging and the foxes appear, God, in our lives, we can cling to you and continue to persist in the fruit of the Spirit and in generosity. I ask all this in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Hi everyone, welcome back. We want to update you on the announcements for this week. Per Pastor Tony's email, we won't be coming together in the evening at 7:30, as usual, Sunday night. So look out for another follow-up email regarding the plans. The leadership team will reach out to all of us and be sure that we know what the plans are going forward in the future. However, during that time, Sunday night from 7 to 8, we're doing a food drive. So we are collecting food for the Angels of Long Island. So you can drop off food, cans, whatever you have near the main entrance of our church building. Also online, if you have any prayer requests, please continue to fill those out if you have any individual prayer needs. As you know, there are so many people willing to stand by you and pray with you, and that's so important to come together and have that unity in the church together. Also, along those lines, we have the Connect Card. So if you don't know, the Connect Card can be used to get involved in the church or connect in any way. So if it's your first or second visit and you want to connect with maybe someone in the leadership team or anyone in the church, it's a great tool to utilize. Or if you've been around for a really long time and something's on your heart and you need to connect in a certain way, then you can fill that out too.
Absolutely. And speaking of connections, there's actually a new service called Connect Now. You'll see it on the bottom of our webpage. It's a little green icon. Be sure to do that if you're interested in finding out more information about the church or actually requesting real-time prayer. Available coming real soon is our baptism. And so if you're interested in being baptized, there's a form online that you can fill out, and we'll get you more information. Social media. Both Facebook and Instagram and Twitter, be sure to follow us. It's really good if you were to like, comment, and even share the posts with your neighbors and your friends. It's a good way to get the word out. So other than that, I think we're good here, and the last thing to do is to hand it off to Pastor Tom.
Woo! He is good. Do we have a good God? Boy, what a good God we have, just seeing all your faces here tonight. Brings great joy, I think, to everyone here, right? I mean, this is so awesome just to see you all tonight. I pray that this message, definitely, I'm excited about it because I want to know that God is the king of my heart and there's nothing else competing for that love, that he is number one, and I don't want any little foxes being on that throne with him. So I pray that as we go about our week, that we would just ask God to reveal any little thing, any big thing that may be on that throne so that it is his love that reigns supreme in us and through us.
You know, I was thinking to myself, I'm thinking, you know, the direction we're going and the forecast we send, like, we don't want to send the message that we're going to be coming here every week and talking about your sin.
Right.
Because that's not really encouraging.
Yeah.
What we're going to be looking at in these next couple of weeks is identifying the fox. And how do we rid that out of our lives?
We.
Right? And that's because I probably didn't make that very clear.
Mm-hmm.
And I just thought, you know what? That's a key to this whole thing. It's not about heaping guilt. It's about bringing us freely into the freedom that Jesus has for us. And so I look forward to these weeks ahead. Amen?
He's going to be the king of our hearts, right?
Amen.
He alone. He alone is worthy. Have a great night. We're going to be starting the movie soon and rolling out some ice cream. So if you're able to stay. That would be great. Otherwise, have a great and safe night. God bless you. We'll see you next week. God bless.